Hello, thank you so much. Thank you to everyone for coming. It's a little bit funny for me that I can't see you, but I feel all of you with me in spirit, those of you participating, and I'm very excited to learn together. Thank you to Torah Stone for hosting this wonderful event and enabling the learning of Torah throughout the world in multiple languages in anticipation of the Chag celebrating Matan Torah. It's really exciting to be a part of it. So thank you. I'll just introduce myself for, you know, like 30 seconds. I'm Avigail Unterberg-Nuriel. I am a fellow in Kollel De'ah, the five-year halacha program in Midrashat Lindenbaum in Yerushalayim. I'm in my fourth year in the program, so Bezrat Hashem, I'm graduating next year, and it's really such a privilege to learn in Ora Torah Stone's Women's Halacha Kollel, and it's very exciting to be here to learn Torah with all of you. I also have the privilege of teaching in the overseas program at Midrashat Lindenbaum. So very grateful to Midrashat Lindenbaum for enabling me to learn and teach, because really all of my learning is for the sake of doing and teaching. And so it's just a very beautiful, synergy in Midrashat Lindenbaum. So without further ado, our time is short. So let's get right to it. Roots to Redemption, a closer look at Megillat Rut. Before we actually talk about Megillat Rut, which of course we will read on Shavuot, I wanted to take a step back and think about Tanakh as a unit. Tanakh, as you know, is broken up into three sections, Torah, Nevi'im, Ketuvim. And I don't know how many of you have thought about the deeper meaning behind these different sections within Tanakh. I know I took for granted for a very, very long time. Okay, so there's Torah, there's Nevi'im, there's Ketuvim. They're just the three sections in Tanakh. There's the Torah, the five books of Moses. Breishit, Shmot, Vayikra, Bamidbar, Devarim. Then there's the books of the Nevi'im. And then there's Ketuvim. So I want to take a closer look at the structure of Tanakh, and more specifically, what we can learn from the existence of Ketuvim as a unit, of course, because Megillat Rut is obviously found in Ketuvim, and what Megillat Rut's location in Ketuvim can tell us about the Megillah itself, about Ge'ulah, about redemption, and about our relationship with God. So the distinction between Torah and Nevi'im is, I think, pretty obvious. The Torah is direct divine revelation. It is Hashem speaking to Moshe in a way that he never spoke to any prophet before him or any prophet after him, as people speak face to face, right? Even more directly than I'm speaking with you now, if you can imagine. It was a level of prophecy that was unique to Moshe Rabbeinu, and he was able to write down the direct word of God, which is the Torah. It's this direct divine revelation. Nevi'im is one step removed from that, right? It is certainly divine revelation. The prophets were hearing directly from God. But it wasn't the same level of revelation that Moshe was privileged to receive. The books of Nevi'im are people writing down the word of God that they received through their lens. And it is a lower level of divine revelation than the Torah is. And while it's still the word of God, it is interpreted by the conduit that is the Navi. So that's the difference between Torah and Nevi'im. And then we get to Ketuvim. And it's sort of always a question mark. I've had this discussion with my students, you know, over the years, a number of times. And I always ask, what is Ketuvim, right? What's going on in Ketuvim? It includes the book of Job. It includes all the five Megillot. It includes Tehillim, Psalms. It includes Mishle, Proverbs. It includes, what am I forgetting? Ezra, Nehemiah. There's all sorts of books in Ketuvim, ranging from different periods in Jewish history, right? Whereas the Torah covers a very specific time period in Jewish history, from the creation of the world until the right before the entrance into Israel with Yehoshua from the desert. And Nevi'im spans from the entrance into Israel with Yehoshua through the destruction of the first Beit HaMikdash. Ketuvim is a little more all over the place chronologically, right? We have Megillat Rut, of course, which takes place in the time of the Shoftim. We have Eicha, which takes place obviously after the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash. We have Tehillim, which is written by David HaMelech when he was king. And so it's less chronologically organized than than the other units of Tanakh. And I always have a student who says, I don't know, Ketuvim is just miscellaneous. So I would like to argue that Ketuvim is not miscellaneous. It's not, oh, here are some books that are important and good, but they don't fit into either of the other categories, so we'll just shove them into a miscellaneous category. I don't think that's what unites Ketuvim. I think the thread that unites Ketuvim is, whereas Torah and Nevi'im were written because God initiated the writings of the book, right? We have the Torah, which obviously God spoke directly to Moshe, and then we have Nevi'im, which are prophecies that prophets received from God, and they wrote down those prophecies for perpetuity. Ketuvim are man-initiated books, right? Why is Eicha, Lamentations, why is that not included in the book of Yirmiyahu, of Jeremiah? Jeremiah wrote Lamentations, so why isn't that included as a chapter of his book, Yirmiyahu? Well, because God didn't tell him to write down Megillat Eicha. Megillat Eicha is a genuine human reaction to the destruction of the Beit HaMikdash, and so it doesn't belong in Nevi'im, it belongs in Ketuvim. Ketuvim demonstrates the many ways that individuals try to access God. And rather than a top-down dynamic, which the Torah and Nevi'im capture, Ketuvim capture a bottom-up dynamic of people calling out to God. And Ketuvim is an endorsement, really, for all future generations to connect with God and to reach out to God to pursue a national and personal relationship with God, because Ketuvim has a wide range of ways to reach out to God. And in a post-prophetic world, which we obviously live in now, and post the prophets of the Second Temple, we've been living in since then. And in a post-prophetic world, it's so, so, so important to have that precedent canonized in Tanakh to show us not only is it okay for man to reach out to God, but there are so many different ways that man can reach out to God. And so that's sort of to frame our conversation about Megillat Rut. I want us to keep that in the backs of our minds, that already Megillat Rut's placement in Ketuvim is telling us something about the messages that the Megillah wants the reader to receive, that this is a bottom-up story. This is a story about human initiative. So let's talk about Shavuot. Before we jump into the Psukim of Megillat Rut, let's talk about Shavuot. I'm going to share my screen with you. We're going to look at a little PowerPoint together. Okay. Before we talk about Shavuot, this is a piece from a very important Bible scholar, Nahum Sarna, where I think he just encapsulates the message of what I'm trying to say about Ketuvim very beautifully. In the law, the Torah, and the prophets, God reaches out to man. The initiative is his. The message is his. He communicates, we receive. Our God-given free will allows us to be receptive, to be accepting, to turn a deaf ear, to reject. In the Psalms and all other books of Ketuvim, right, I'm adding, human beings reach out to God. The initiative is human. We make an effort to communicate. He receives, he chooses to respond or not according to his inscrutable wisdom. He gives his assent or withholds it. In the Psalms, the human soul extends itself beyond its confining, sheltering, impermanent house of clay. It gropes for an experience of the divine presence. The biblical Psalms are essentially a record of the human quest for God. Okay, so obviously Sarna here is talking about Tehillim specifically, but I think this can be expanded to all of Ketuvim, and he said it better than I could. So I wanted to bring his words in his name, and it's, I think, a very powerful idea. When we think about all of the books in Ketuvim, we're going to obviously focus on Megillat Rut for today. And when we think about Shavuot, and we think about the top-down and bottom-up nature of the Chag, if we start with the top-down, right? It's very easy. What's the top-down nature of the holiday of Shavuot? Matan Torah, right? It doesn't get more top-down than Matan Torah. Literally, Am Yisrael standing at the foot of the mountain and God giving the Torah at Har Sinai. Ma'amad Har Sinai, the giving of the Torah at Har Sinai, na'aseh v'nishma, we will listen and we will do. It doesn't get more top-down than that. And that, I think, is an obvious aspect of the Chag of Shavuot, of the acceptance of the Torah and the acceptance of this reciprocal relationship with God. Megillat Rut, I think, helps us see a bottom-up perspective on redemption, whereas the top-down redemption that we're celebrating on Shavuot is the culmination of the redemption of the Exodus that we've been counting up to, right, since Pesach. We've been counting up to the revelation at Mount Sinai, that top-down redemption, which is the culmination of the Exodus, the reason we left Egypt. And I want to explore a little bit more what the bottom-up aspect of the redemptive nature of Shavuot is. Okay, so let's think about Matan Torah. Let's think about the giving of the Torah at Mount Sinai, which obviously happens in Sefer Shmot, in the book of Exodus. And the Ramban, in his introduction to the book of Exodus, says the following. And just for the sake of time, I think we're not going to read all of the sources inside, unfortunately, but we'll read bits and pieces inside, and I'll show you the source while I talk about the source outside. And places where we don't have time to read all of the words. Okay, so the Ramban talks about how after the end of all of the stories of the Avot, we have this next book, which is all about the Galut of Mitzrayim, the exile of Mitzrayim, and the redemption from it, which of course was foretold to Avraham in Bereishit already. Vehina, I'm reading here after these three dots. Vehina hagalut enenu nishlam ad yom shuvam el nekomam ve'el ma'alat avotam yeshuvu. The exile is not over until they return to the place and the level of their fathers, their forefathers. Ukshayatzu mi Mitzrayim, afal pi sheyatzu mi beit avadim, adayin yechshavu golim. And even after they were taken out of Egypt, they're still considered exiled because they are in a land which is not theirs, in the wilderness. And when they get to Mount Sinai and build the tabernacle, Vishav Hakadosh Baruchu, Vishresh Chinato Benehem, and God returned to them, and his presence resided amongst them, as shavu el ma'alat avotam, ve'az nechshavu ge'ulim. Only then have they returned to the elevated level of their forefathers, and only then are they considered redeemed. V'lachen nishlam ha-sefer hazeh b'hashlimo inyan ha-mishkan u'behiyot kvod Hashem male oto tamid. And that's why Sefer Shmot ends with the Mishkan and the building of the tabernacle and God's presence, the Shechinah coming to reside amongst the people, because that really is the true redemption. And the Ramban here is obviously talking about a very top-down redemption, right? He's talking about the giving of the Torah at Mount Sinai. He's talking about the Shekhinah residing in the presence of the people. And he's also talking about the restorative nature of Ge'ulah. We're going to explore the word Ge'ulah in different contexts to try and weed out the different aspects of this big word Ge'ulah, redemption. What does redemption mean? And to try to understand it in all of its aspects on a deeper level. So for the Ramban, Ge'ulah is restorative. Right? Redemption is to return the people of Israel to the levels of their forefathers. There's a restorative nature to Ge'ulah. And until God resides amongst the people, they have not reached the restorative nature of that redemption. And that's the Ramban. Here we have in Sefer Shmot, Perek Vav, the famous Lishonot Ge'ulah, the description of the redemption. God is reassuring Moshe after he gets into some setbacks when he first goes to Paro, and God is reassuring Moshe that everything is going to be okay. And he talks about the redemption that he is going to perform for Am Yisrael. And what this adds to our understanding of Ge'ulah, of redemption, is that redemption is for a specific purpose. It is in order to bring the people of Israel into the relationship with God and to form that national relationship with the divine in order to accomplish what we need to accomplish, which of course comes later also earlier in Sefer Bereishit and later in Tanakh. But it adds to the aspect of Ge'ulah that it is not only redemption for the sake of redemption, to return us to the level of our forefathers, for the sake of returning us to the level of our forefathers, because God made a promise to Abraham, but it's also for a more concrete, specific purpose. Here in Sefer Bamidbar, it talks about the Goel Hadam, right? The famous case where when somebody is murdered, the person who wants to avenge that murder is called the Goel. And this brings out the aspect of Ge'ulah, which is righting a wrong, or in other words, justice. That there is an aspect of doing what is just is redemptive. I apologize, I'm rushing through these a little bit because I want to make sure we have enough time. Here in Sefer Vayikra, we again have the aspect of restoration when it talks about restoring a poor person to his land. And we also have the aspect of taking care of the weak. Okay, so we said, just to review quickly, we said restoration, we said for a specific purpose, we said justice, and taking care of the weak. Those are all important aspects of what I would call technical ge'ulah, physical ge'ulah, taking the Jews out of Egypt, avenging a loved one's murder, restoring a poor person's property. They are all what I would call technical or physical redemption. And in Megillat Rut, the word ge'ulah is also technical and physical. Naomi here is describing Boaz as migoalenu hu, that he is related to us and he is somebody who could redeem us. Boaz is saying to Rut, Boaz is talking to Rut about redeeming her. And here, Boaz and the other family member, who's a closer family member, who could have had the opportunity to redeem Ruth, but in the end allows Boaz to do it. They're all talking about this physical, technical redemption of redeeming the family of Naomi and restoring their land and their former stature. But I'm actually going to stop sharing my screen for a moment here. Let's take a step back for a moment and think about the process that Naomi goes through from the beginning of the Megillah to the end. It's not a long Megillah, right? There aren't many chapters. It's four chapters. It's a fast-paced story, but Naomi and Ruth and Boaz all go through an intense transformation. And the people of Beit Lechem also go through an intense transformation. And there is what I would call spiritual ge'ulah happening in the Megillah, in addition to the physical or technical ge'ulah, right? Naomi comes back after her and her family had basically, you know, run out of town when there was a famine in Beit Lechem and ran away to Moab. And then she comes back a little bit with her tail between her legs. She's very embarrassed. The people of Beit Lechem are not necessarily so supportive of her. And she just thinks her life is over. Her stature is gone. Her husband and her sons are gone. And she's going to live out the rest of her life in this sad state. And the end of the Megillah presents a very different story, right? There is a spiritual redemption happening in a addition to the technical and physical redemption. So while we saw with physical and technical ge'ulah that the midot, that the qualities or attributes required for the physical ge'ulah, for the physical redemption, are what I would say tzedek and mishpat, right? Righteousness and justice. Those are what I would say are the attributes that are important for physical redemption. So what midah is required for spiritual ge'ulah? What attributes are required for spiritual redemption? And the Megillah shows us. The Megillah tells us three times with a word and a theme that is central in the Megillah, which is chesed, right? We have first, of course, I'll share the PowerPoint again. I just didn't want to give it away. We have, one second. Hang on. Sorry, I'm having a little trouble sharing the PowerPoint, but I'll just say it for the sake of time. Here, I'm going to try one more time. Okay. There we go. Pretty sure that worked this time. The Megillah tells us three times the word chesed appears in the Megillah. The first time Naomi is saying it to Ruth and Orpah, to her daughters-in-law, that God should do chesed for them when she thinks she is departing from them. Really, she's not departing from Ruth. The second time is in Perek Bet. Naomi is again talking to Ruth and saying that when Ruth tells her that Boaz, that she was in the field of Boaz, Naomi is describing Hashem as Hashem's chesed, and because Boaz is actually related to them and can be a redeemer. And the last time chesed is mentioned in the Megillah, Boaz is actually talking to Ruth, and he says, "Heitavt chesdecha acharon min harishon. Your last chesed was even greater than your first chesed." Her first chesed being joining Naomi on her journey back to Beit Lechem and taking care of her, even though she really didn't have to do that. Societally, that was not the expectation of her. And the last chesed that she did is going to Boaz to redeem her when she could have asked a younger man to redeem her where Boaz was older. And what the theme of chesed is here is going above and beyond what is expected of you. Ruth was certainly not expected to go with Naomi. Naomi tells her daughters-in-law to go back to their parents' house because that's what society expected of them. Ruth goes above and beyond and does this act of chesed for her mother-in-law and joins her in Beit Lechem to take care of her for the rest of her life. And we see in the Megillah that every act of chesed generates another act of chesed, that chesed begets chesed begets chesed. And that is maybe the central theme of the Megillah, which the Midrash says that this Megillah, kula chesed v'atorah kula chesed, that the entire message of the Megillah is chesed. And that is what brings about the spiritual redemption of a family. The physical redemption of the family is brought about through tzedek and mishpat, through righteousness and justice. The spiritual geulah is through the act of chesed. So where does chesed fit in to our top-down, bottom-up dynamic that we were talking about at the beginning of the shiur? As you know, in the Yud Gimel Midot, describing God's attributes of mercy, chesed is mentioned twice. God's presence couldn't reside with the people of Israel without the employment of chesed, without the midah of chesed. And Megillah Ruth really encapsulates the top-down and bottom-up dynamic, both as a sefer in Tanakh and in its illustration as of chesed and geulah. That Megillah Ruth, first of all, its place in Ketuvim is inherently bottom-up. And us reading it on Shavuot, the Chag that is seemingly the most top-down, right? The Matan Torah, the receiving, Am Yisrael receiving the Torah, God giving the Torah. The fact that we read this book that not only is written by under man's initiation, not because God said to write it, but also the entire story is a redemption that can be brought about because mankind helped other members of mankind, or, you know, in this case, a woman helped her mother-in-law, and Boaz helped that woman. And these human acts of chesed are what are bringing the, I'm getting a heads up, two more minutes. I'm almost done. These human acts of chesed are what bring about the physical and spiritual redemption. What makes up the common meeting place between God approaching us top down and us reaching out to God are chesed and ge'ula, that dynamic of chesed and ge'ula. And it's so fitting that David HaMelech is the result of such a union, that David is the bridge between bottom up and top down. He represents both the person chosen by God and the descendant of these Baalei Chesed, these people who did Chesed. Both redemptive forces compose what Am Yisrael is. And that's why David HaMelech is the perfect person to eventually establish the ultimate meeting place between God and man on Har HaBayit. And a religious message on an individual level for us is that we can't sit passively and wait for Ge'ulah to come, wait for only a top-down redemption. The Megillah teaches us that by redeeming ourselves through chesed, through acting above and beyond what might be societally required of us, we bring the ultimate redemption closer and closer. And so my bracha to all of us and to all of Am Yisrael is that we merit to bring the Ge'ulah closer through acts of chesed and acts of tzedek and mishpat, and we merit to see the Ge'ulah Shlema. Have a Chag Sameach.